We're speaking now with Dennis Bonham. He's the Senior Vice President for Business Development here in Asia for GDF Suez LNG. Thanks so much for stopping by and talking to us today. Where do you see the new growth in the LNG demand across Asia? Short, medium, long term, are there differences? Where is the growth coming?
Thank you for the question. I think indeed we should differentiate between long-term demand, which has its own drivers, and short-term demand, which is probably affected by more conjunctural events. So in the long term, and it's been going on for quite a few years, again, we should also differentiate between what we call the old or conventional Asian countries, or the more OECD countries, in particular Japan, Korea, Taiwan, where demand in LNG is going to be at best stable or something like 1% growth over the long term, mostly because these are very mature countries. They have already a lot of infrastructures and they've been buying LNG for 40 years. And in these three countries represent something like 50% of the demand, so they are mature. It's the non-OECD countries that represent the bulk of the growth. If you will listen to the consultants, I don't know if we should, they represent, non-OECD growth for these countries represents something like 10% per annum. Of course, the bulk of it comes from China. Then you have India, and you have all the new countries which are our neighbors here, Singapore, of course, but also our next door neighbor, which used to be a big LNG exporter and which now starts importing. You have Malaysia as well, Indonesia, of course. And then, in the longer term, there will probably be even new importing countries which should add more growth demand. So people talk about the Philippines, Pakistan, Vietnam, why not? So that's probably where the growth will be coming from. Now, for the OECD countries, the traditional importers, the story is a bit bleaker, in particular because, as most of the rest of the OECD, the demand is probably much slower and probably affected also by energy saving measures, restart of nuclear, for example, for Japan and most likely Korea. So that's where we need to differentiate. Now, in the short term today, you can see the strong growth in the countries that have just started importing. Typical example is here in Singapore, but also in Thailand, where growth, of course, at the beginning of the imports is very high.
Is there any one area that you are personally particularly excited about where you see the growth being the best?
I think, as I mentioned, China is obviously the core. They've gone in 6 or 7 years, they've gone from zero to 20 million tons last year. And the country is, of course, immense. Its needs are equally immense. Now, there are other factors that are probably a bit slowing down this demand, but that's probably a core area. I think the new Southeast Asian countries as well are first being much more environmental aware or worried. They all need a lot of natural gas. They used to be exporters in the case of Malaysia and Indonesia, and now they need to either keep their own resources or even import. So these would probably be the best focus.
So you mentioned China as being important to your growth plans, but their growth is slowing, and I wonder how much that's impacting your plans for the future.
So indeed, we've been working on China for quite a few years, and we've even created a specific business unit in China for GDF Suez, the whole group, which includes all the energy activities of GDF Suez. That includes so power, but also energy services, district cooling, district heating, gas storage, pipeline, LNG, everything. So everything is now centralized because you need to have a Chinese policy and a Chinese focus. So we have developed, therefore, a unified business unit which handles China. Obviously, we've noticed that China's demand in energy is slowing down. In particular, we've been able to have one of our FSRUs, floating regas ships, in Tianjin for the last few years, and we'll also have an LNG supply contract with Sinopec, one of the three Chinese companies. But now, looking at the future, obviously it will slow down. Well, first because the recent growth could not be sustainable, not only in energy but for the rest of the commodities, and also because they still are very concerned about the environment. And they are focusing on natural gas, but I think their first focus as well is now budget control, and they want to probably be more careful about their investments. They also see that the domestic demand is probably not as strong as it used to be, and there are also competing gas import projects with pipelines. So altogether, yes, China will be a very important piece for us, and especially an LNG importer, and also new infrastructures being built, which is very important to us as well. Not as fast as in the past, so there might be a bit of a slowdown, but it, compared to Europe, there's no doubt that it's much better.
Do you have any concerns about the possibility of a gas glut in this region?
Unfortunately, yes. I don't think it's in the region. I think it's for the LNG market altogether. What we can see happening is the LNG growth is by spurts. So in the past few years, there's been almost no new liquefaction plants, so new supply, very limited supply additions to the market. And now we're just beginning what we call the new LNG wave, with about 100 million tons worth of capacity out of a market of 250 that will be coming from Australia and the States. And this wave is obviously targeting the first LNG market, which is Asia. So a lot of these volumes will be fixed into Asia. So what we can see starting even now to happen is that a lot of the volumes that were being diverted from the Atlantic basin, mostly from Europe, into Asia in the past few years when demand was very strong and therefore spot prices were very high, then all these volumes that were diverted are progressively and will progressively come back to Europe as a market of last resort, and as a consequence, the domestic or the regional markets will probably be well supplied, and then the excess volumes will probably go back to Asia when there's still a liquid market. Sorry, back to Europe when there's still a liquid market. So a long response to say yes, it's quite likely that there will be a glut until the last 3-4 years of the decade, and then, as usual in this industry, it will reverse. A new cycle will start because we're not investing. So in early 2020s, we're quite likely to have a new cycle of a short market and higher prices, the usual cycle.
So this is just the circle of life,
yes,
in the LNG industry. So do you see the LNG pricing in Asia changing significantly due to that cycle or due to any other factors?
What I see happening is probably more an acceleration of the current trend, which is Asian buyers want to get away from being 90% or 80% indexed on oil. So they want probably to get away from single indexation on a product that used to be very expensive, which is now much more affordable. They also want more flexibility in terms of purchasing. So there are in the current negotiations that we're now having, off-takers or customers want to have more possibilities to divert, so we can do that together. They want to have more flexibility in terms of indexation, as I said. They want to have ways to reduce the risk with, for example, S-curves, which is a system to reduce strong increases or strong decreases in price. They want more cooperation between buyers and sellers. So that's what you see happening in Japan and Korea, when there's even joint procurement. We can see this clearly happening in Japan with the likely merger of two portfolios. One of them is Chubu, with whom we enjoy very good relations. So all this together, yes, the commercial and pricing trends in Asia are probably going to accelerate towards more cooperation, more flexibility, and more diversification.
And where is GDF going to be investing to make sure that you have the product for the clients when they want it?
So there are two main areas where we invest in LNG. The first one is liquefaction. So we have started and will continue investing for the next 4 years in a major LNG liquefaction project in the US called Cameron. So we'll be a shareholder in the project, and we'll also be one of the three major off-takers of the project. So we'll be buying 4 million tons of LNG, and it will be liquefying the natural gas that will buy in the US, liquefy it in the States, then ship it mostly to Asia. So that's our main investment, which is mostly a liquefaction investment in the plant, which is located in the Gulf of Mexico in the States. Now, we will most likely also take new shipping capacity. Here we'll probably not invest directly, but what's more customary in the industry is to invest in long-term shipping capacity. Usually we invest in 15 to 20 year charters for LNG tankers. And at the last side of the LNG chain, we are also investing in downstream assets, so mostly regasification assets. So in the case of Asia, for example, we have projects in India, in Kakinada, to have a floating regasification terminal to import again LNG and regasify that in Asia. We also are in the early stages of a process to invest in Indonesia in an onshore project on the island of Java to supply. So our objective is really to invest to long-term to have long-term investments all along the LNG and value chain.
Including in Asia and elsewhere around the
yes,
world.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. We're also investing in Latin America.
We've been speaking with Dennis Bonham, the SVP for Business Development at GDF Suez LNG.